Thanks for joining us this morning here at Lighthouse Family Church Online. I'd like to introduce Pastor Lisa, who's going to bring us the word.
Welcome to Lighthouse Church this morning. It's great to be with you this morning. My message today is I'm talking about God wants you. Really, it's from the harvest to the harvest. In Luke chapter 19, verse 10, it says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost." It was actually talking to Zacchaeus. And Zacchaeus was short in stature, so he wanted to see Jesus coming along the road, and he climbs up a tree. And then we know the story goes on that Jesus says, "Can I come to your house and have dinner with you?" And Zacchaeus is absolutely ecstatic with that. Do you know that the change in Zacchaeus' life, everyone else at that moment of time would remember that the tax collectors were like the scum of the earth. There was nothing really good about them. I think if you'd put them in a dark alley, somebody would have liked to kill them off. And here's Jesus coming, and he says, "I came to seek and save that which was lost." What an amazing response. I'm thinking about other people that the same thing happened. Who did Jesus come for? He didn't come for the righteous. He came for those that were down and out, those that were hopeless, those that were recognizing that they needed a savior. And so the amazing thing is that it was the woman at the well. It was the woman that was caught in adultery. It was Paul on the road to Damascus. We think of all of these different characters. Rahab. Every person that the Lord picked out of the disciples, there was still something wrong with them. They may have had anger issues or some sort of issues. So we start off, and if he came to seek and save that which was lost, his greatest mission is that he cares about you. First and foremost, before you can do anything for the Lord, he actually cares about you. He sent his Son to come and die for us. And it wasn't just his Son, because the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are co-equal, co-eternal, co-existent. Everything that they did was all a part of who God was, who the Father is, who Jesus is. And so there was a rescue mission way back from the beginning of the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve were given the tree of knowledge of good and evil not to eat. But they chose to eat of that fruit. And God had to put that tree in the garden because that gave them the ability to be able to choose. God didn't want robots. He didn't want puppets. And they did. They chose to eat of the fruit. At the point of time when they ate that fruit, they actually took of a knowledge that was good and evil. It's not just the evil of that tree that was bad. It's the good. It's the self-righteous part of us. It's the part of us that says, "I don't need God. I can do it my way." You know, God put us here on the earth, and I don't know about you, but just as parents, and we have our children, and we don't want to not have a relationship with them, but we can't control them. They still have their choices, they still make their decisions, and that is how God is with us. There are only two kingdoms in the world. There is the kingdom of Satan, which when Adam and Eve ate of that tree of knowledge of good and evil, they opened up to another kingdom. And Jesus wanted to rescue mankind back into his family and back into his kingdom. And he did it 4,000 years later through his Son. Let's just pick it up with Paul. And I think about Paul. He was one that was persecuting the Christians. They were called the people of the way. And he wanted to kill whether male or female, whoever was actually sharing the good news of the gospel. Let's pick it up in Acts 9:33 to verse 8. And it says, "As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. And he heard a voice saying, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' And Saul said, 'Who are you, Lord?' And he said, 'I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting.' And then he said to him, 'It is hard for you to kick against the goads.'" Goads are like prodding sticks. It's like a cattle pen, and you're just trying to push the cattle around, and they were like that. And Jesus is really saying to him, "How can you kick against the goads? There's always something happening in your life. You are being headed in towards this direction." And then we know that he says, "Lord, what must I do?" And the Lord said, "Arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." What an amazing conversion. When Paul had that experience, he was laid a hold of for the purposes and plans of God at that moment. When we talk about new birth, as in, I think it's John 3:3, and it's Nicodemus is speaking to Jesus, and he said, how can a man be born again? How can he enter his mother's womb? And Jesus said, you must be born of water and of the Spirit to enter the kingdom of heaven. And what happened at that point of time? Nicodemus says, well, how can I go back into my mother's womb? I'm a big person, that's not possible. And when Jesus says you must be born of water, there's two theories to that. Some people believe that you must be water baptized and then filled with the Spirit. Other people say that the first birth was born of the mother's waters, and when those waters broke, you were birthed into this world. The second birth is a spiritual something. It's when we say, Jesus, I need you as my Lord and Savior. And Jesus then, and you say, I need help. I acknowledge that my life, I need you in my life. And then God comes in. That is what it means to be born again. Jesus is the entrance into the kingdom. He is the door. You cannot get into the kingdom by any other way, not through a gate, not through anything else, but you must come through Jesus. And every other religion says, you know, they are a part of a way. You could be a Muslim, you could be a Buddhist, you could be following New Age and any other things. Or we could say all roads lead to God. But Jesus is the one who here very clearly says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. So as they journeyed, Saul then became the person who wrote two-thirds of the New Testament. He lived an amazing, amazing life. The scripture that we have now is in Philippians 3:12, and it says, not that I've obtained or already perfected, but I press on to lay a hold of all that Christ has laid a hold of for me. Brethren, I don't count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind me and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul, who better to say that he had obtained? He was one of those that was a Pharisee and he kept the law and all the religious systems, and yet he's saying, not that I've obtained. It was Christ who attained everything for him. It's not that we've done anything fantastic, but when we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, it means that He comes and lives on the inside of us so that we can obtain to be all that God wants for us. Paul said, I forget those things which are behind. He had to forget all the things that he'd done wrong. He had to forget that he was having Stephen murdered and martyred. He had to forget about all those other things because there would have been blockages and guilts and shame that would have kept him from being obedient to the call of God. I don't know about you, but I had to get to the point in my life where I could be used by God because I'd lived an awful life before I became a Christian. I was brought up in maybe not such a good home. Mum had married her second cousin, and I was about 4 years old when that happened. And he'd gone to jail for 17 years for murder. He got out when he was 34, and then they made a go of life for a good 10 years. In that life, it wasn't the best because Peter had been a really handsome looking guy and a young guy. So he was abused and he had homosexual tendencies. And so when he got out of prison, there was all sorts of issues that we probably had in our family life. But you know, we made the best of it. But when people found out about my stepdad's background, it was not a good thing. I didn't have any friends come over and not much friendship because nobody wanted to come to the murderer's house. There was all sorts of talk and gossip, and so I guess we became very shut down as a family. I went to 9 different schools growing up. We were always on the run. My real dad was looking for me for many years and couldn't find me. Mum was always on the run. She didn't want to lose me. Mum was a tough nut. Now, I don't mean this in an awful sense. Everybody has their upbringings, and since I've been a parent, I can actually look at things totally different. I was as equally frustrating as she was annoying to me. But Mum didn't want me to turn out like she had, so she was very, very strict. Mum was a perfectionist and I could never match up, so I learned to live out of, I can't, I'm hopeless, I'm dumb. That was my mantra. It became the belief system that began to shape my world. I ended up getting into wrong friendships, ended up stealing a lot. By the time I was 15, I had become rebellious and ended up in Longmore Prison for, it's a juvenile detention centre. How did I end up there? Started stealing when I was young. Then I got into my first job and I started stealing out of the cash register, keeping the dockets of the food that was bought and keeping the money for myself. I got sacked from my first job and then of course I ended up getting another job. And this job, I worked there for 3 months in the kitchen and I was fantastic. The first day he said to me, I'm going to put you on the till. I already had a plan of how to take all the money out of the safe, and which I did. My friend came in, and on that first day I was on the till, she came to pick me up. She was about 10 minutes early. And I said, quick, take everything I had. I'd stuck it into a packet of women's pads and put all the money in there. Next minute, the whole place is locked down. In comes the police, they're checking us, doing body searches, doing all sorts of searches around the place, and they didn't find it. But my boss came over to me and he said, I know it was you. He said, I had given you an opportunity. I wanted to take you on and give you another chance. And you know, I think those words, when he said that, broke me down. It was Neil's Pancake Place. It was right across in the cinema in Perth, right across, there was KFC, Red Rooster, and then this little pancake place. So off I ended up in prison because I admitted to what had happened. I was there a few days until my mum could come down and get me out and then had to have a trial and I got back out again. I think that was a really good thing for me because it made me realise I didn't want to be a stealer. I don't think I really wanted to end up in prison again. But we all make mistakes. When I realised that I'd become so hardened one time was, I remember when I was getting told off as a kid and I was probably about nearly 15, and I remember singing that song at the top of my voice, I don't care what you say anymore, this is my life. Go to hell with your own life, but leave mine alone. I became really cold and hard. As a kid, I'd been a kid that loved animals, loved old people, cared about things. But from that moment, that inner decision that I made, an inner vow, I changed. I went about doing things that were really horrible and brutal and awful. I didn't care whether it was relationships I was ruining or what I was doing. I knew I'd got to a hardened place when my friend and I, we met this old man. And this old man used to come down and he always had a wallet full of money. And he would give us money and he just wanted friendship and we just wanted his money. So we would go and visit him. Anyway, one day my friend and I were at our home and we had actually asked four young guys that we knew to jump on this old man as he was coming to our house for a meal because he was just walking down the road to our house. Next minute, knock, knock on the door and in comes this old man. We could not believe it. We hadn't even got tea ready. And these guys, he had fought them off. I guess he might have been 70, 75, somewhere around there. And he'd fought them off. But a few months later, my friend and I went over to see him at his place and he was slumped over the table. And I remember saying to my friend, quick, let's get everything we can and let's get out of here. How horrible that I'd got to that point of my life where I could be so hard. Later on, I did find out that he'd survived. And that was a godsend. I don't know how I would have coped with the guilt of those sorts of things that take place in your life. But I had become cold and hard. I was working at a Crazy Cats nightclub avenue. I worked at Hungry Jack's from 10 to 2, 5 to 9. Then at 9 o'clock we'd go across and I worked at a strip place. And I got paid $1.40 back then for every drink you drank. You'd be throwing your drinks down the pots and I'd drink a lot of them. We'd be drunk as skunks, but you'd be throwing them all down. Then I'd start work back at Hungry Jack's. Just an awful, awful lifestyle. Then I went over and went down and started working in the shearing teams and got involved in the shearing teams. And I absolutely loved the shearing team life, but it was parties, it was drugs, it was all sorts of things that were going on. I went to New Zealand and I worked in the shearing teams. We'd start at 5 in the morning, so we'd be up at 4:30 and then we would finish at 5 at night. We'd go down to the pub, drink till 11, get up at 4:30. It was just one of the hardest lifestyles that I could have ever lived. Got involved in a lot of stuff in New Zealand, ran out of money, all sorts of bad things happened, and maybe one day I'll share that. But at this point, I just wanted to get a little bit of the story of that God wants to rescue you. The greatest mission is that God was chasing me down. When I was in part of these things, God was always working on my life. I remember with my friend when we're doing all sorts of bad things, I said, don't you believe that God's real? And they said, oh, that's just you with a guilty conscience. And then later on, a few years later, I'd got involved when I was in the shearing teams. There was a bit of a holiday time and there was not much work. I stayed at the shearing teams and stayed in the quarters there. And this I think Jehovah's Witnesses came around. They gave me a whole heap of books. But there was this lady, a Christian lady who was working a shop, and she said, come and stay with me. She said, I can't give you much money, but she said, I can give you board free. And she said, if you get rid of all those books, I'll give you a Bible. So she bought me a Bible and she wrote in it, John 14:6, I am the way, the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. I was having out of body experiences, astro travel. I'd got involved in mystical, moving things and all sorts of things and power things. And when I was in my worst time and I couldn't control those things because they were like vibrations going through my body and I just over and over and over and I couldn't break it. I would be not asleep but not awake in that semi-conscious state. And I'd be freaking out, but those words, I'm the way, I am the truth, I am the life, they would go over in my head and that was enough to begin to break the power that the enemy had over my life. I had many different demonic visitations over the times, and I'm not insane. I know what I've experienced. So the greatest thing for me was my salvation was that I got baptized. I went to a charismatic convention, and it was 1986. I had absolute anger issues. My husband and I had split up at one point of time because of the violence. I'd smash his head into mirrors, smash plates on the floor, just such an anger. We went to this charismatic convention and there was 10,000 Christians just worshiping and praising the Lord. And I felt so agitated. I was in, out, in, out, in, out. Then all of a sudden I stepped back inside and it was like this hand just ripped inside of me and then pulled up and out went out the top of my head. It just went whoosh, whoosh, whoosh as the demonic spirit just left me. I was left trembling all over. I didn't know actually what it was at the time, but I was left trembling. Then the song Amazing Grace came on. How sweet the sound, and the preacher must have preached a message, and I went down and on an altar call. They said, come on, there's one more person. God's calling you. Today is the day of salvation. And I went down the front and answered that call. A couple of days later, I was filled with the Holy Spirit, and God has done an amazing work in me. Did it happen overnight? No, it's taken years of working through some of the hurts and some of the situations that I had to go through in life. But amazing, God rescued me. He chases me down. He leaves the 99 to come after and rescue you. So before we do anything else, we know that God is interested in us. Paul said in our days, it was going to be harder to be a Christian than it was in his days. He says, perilous times will come in 2 Timothy 3:1-5. But know this, in the last days, for men will be lovers of themselves, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutish, despisers of good, having a form of godliness, but denying the power. And from such people, turn away. This is not talking about the unbelievers. This is talking to the church, that there would be a time that we'd be in facing in our lives where we would have a form of godliness, but we would forget the power like that would set me free. The power to heal the sick and raise the dead and change lives and transform lives. You know, most people just want to stay in their sin and have a form of grace. But God wants more than that. He gets glory when a life is transformed. With a woman at the, when she was caught in adultery, he said, I forgive you, but go and sin no more. To Zacchaeus, he actually said, I'm going to go and sell off and give back 4 times what I have stolen. And to anybody else, I want to bless them 1/2 time more. There was a change, there was a transformation, but now we want to come in out of the perversion that I had lived in and some of the things that I haven't shared about, but God rescued me. He didn't leave me in that sin-sick state. He rescued me and He changes me. He says, I use the foolish things to confound the wise. God rescues people whose heart are loyal to Him or want to know Him or are thankful for all that He has done for us. Paul had been beaten 39 times, five times, five different lots of 39 lashes. I think I worked out five, fours are 20. So let's say 195 times of lashes that he got into his body. He was beaten with batons three times. He was shipwrecked. He was stoned. He was persecuted. He was bitten by a snake. He was put in prison. All these things he did. But yet he's saying it's harder for us to be a Christian in our world because we have so much things that can captivate our hearts and our times. Paul was sold out. He said, I press on to lay a hold of. Do you know the things that I have realized is when you lay a hold of something, when Christ comes to lay a hold of you, he comes to captivate you, to turn you upside down. He loves you enough not to leave you the same, but he wants to change you to become the all that you possibly could have been before the world got a hold of you. And so lay a hold of means every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places is mine in Christ. I said to you before that Jesus is the door and door into the kingdom. You don't get to heaven unless you come through Jesus. But once you go through that door, there's a whole kingdom power that can change your life and transform you and take you from your hopeless circumstances into an amazing lifestyle. But we've got to go through that door. We can't just stop at the door and say, I'm saved. And that's what many people are trying to do in our days today. Paul predicted it. He said we would have a form of godliness, but deny the power that can change us. What is that power that can change us? If we look back over history, the greatest battle that the church would have found or had to work through was that they were in law. What is law? Law is keeping all the Ten Commandments and doing all the things that you think are right. You may not have a relationship with God, but you feel good because you've done good things. So the Old Testament church was still trying to come into the New Testament and they were trying to bring in this legalism. And we know how Jesus spoke to the Pharisees. He said, you whitewash tombs or you whitewash walls. You know, how can you think you're going to depart from the wrath of God? They thought that they were keeping all the commandments, but their hearts were evil. You can do everything on the outward, but not on the inward. The greatest battle we face today is now is lawlessness. It's salvation without change. We hear about it. Oh, well, I'm just in, this is who I am. This is my lot in life. Grace is God meeting us at our point of need in the person of Jesus Christ, including all his power and all his provision. He did not leave us where we could not overcome circumstances and situations. He didn't leave me in my sin and my perversion. He transformed me and changes me. And now I can hold my head up. I'm not ashamed of who I've become. Whereas in my past, I hated who I'd become. In Matthew 24, verse 12, it says, Jesus warns, sin will be rampant and the love of many will grow cold, but those who endure to the end will be saved. To endure to the end and the love of many would grow cold, he's talking again to the church. That we would just have this form of, okay, sera, sera, whatever will be. We go about doing our life, but all of a sudden we're caught up in the world and we've lost our passion, we've lost our heart, we've lost our love for the Lord. Remember, the eyes of the Lord go to and fro over the whole earth looking for those who are loyal to him. The next slide that we have is, when we think about this, it says 40% of people believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God. In 2 Timothy 3:16, it says, for all scripture is given by inspiration of God, it's profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness, that the man of God be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. The word of God, if we don't believe that it's the inspired word of God, then that means that it's left to half-truths and mistruths. But I believe that the word of God is as it is, as it's written, that is how it is. For God chases us down. He's not putting legalism and law upon us. He actually wants us to be free. The best freedom I've had is when I've come out of the sin and the debauchery and the abased thinkings and programming, I've become free. But in the past, I thought that was freedom. But then the devil just ensnares you and enslaves you. The devil wants to bring in lawlessness because in the last days, when the Antichrist begins to arise, he must come to a lawless world. He will look like the Prince of Peace in that world, but the lawless one. We live in a world of lawlessness today. Matthew 24, verse 12 to 13. And it says there, Jesus warns sin will be rampant, and the love of many will grow cold, but those who endure to the end shall be saved. What an amazing thought, to endure. He's not talking about the unchurched, he's talking about the saved, that we would grow cold and that we would grow lukewarm, that we would have a form of godliness, but we wouldn't actually acknowledge the power that brings transformation and change and be the testimony and the witness of him to the world. I've already shared there's only two kingdoms. You're either part of the kingdom of darkness or the kingdom of light. We get our whole life to make a decision and a choice for where we're going to spend our life. God gives you that time, but nobody knows the day or hour when that would be end for us. And the whole thing is that God has been chasing us down. He leaves the 99 to find you and I and to rescue us. Just like he's given me opportunities, I'm sure that there's been opportunities around every person's life that you had before you made the decision to become a Christian. In the last days, we know that lawlessness will abound. What is lawlessness? It's just everybody does what they think's right in their own eyes. There is no truth. There's nothing that we hold on to, so everybody just makes up their own truth. And then all of a sudden we lose our way because we have nothing to bring ourselves back to. And really that's the place where the Antichrist, we know in the last days, that they want a globalization of a world. And they will bring in a one world leader who will want to bring peace into the chaos of the world. Why do I like Donald Trump, and this is not a push for it for you, but for me, what it is that Donald Trump is a nationalist. We know that once that one world order is in, they're only given 7 years of that one world order where they begin to control it. And then the Antichrist appears of who he is. So why Donald Trump's in and why we have Brexit and all those things, we are pushing away from the globalist agenda. There are a lot of people that there's the Illuminati group, it then goes to the billionaire club, there's people that want to run the world, there's people in high places of all the CIA and all the banking systems that are all pushing towards the globalization of our world. But lawlessness would be a sign of that last day and the great falling away. And so we want to be able to preach a message that this is our time to begin to get out and preach the good message and the good news and the hope of Jesus Christ to our world. In Acts 13, 36, it says, David served his generation. And his generation was an amazing generation. He served his generation with all he possibly could. He doesn't serve the next generation or anyone else. We can leave things behind. But then it said he died. This is our time to serve our generation, just like Esther, she said, for such a time as this was I born. And she was also there to deliver her people. She gained favor, which is God's grace. Grace is God's favor upon your life, that people would hear what you have to say because of the integrity. If there's no integrity, you're not going to have favor. So if we're living a lawless life and trying to live a Christian life, we're not going to have favor. And our voice would be like a noisy gong. But at the time, because of her favor with the king, he listened and heeded and she rescued her people. It's time for us to be like that in our generation. We won't be able to talk to the next generation, but you were born for this generation, for the year 2020. You are here for this generation of people, for whoever you meet and the people that come across your path to begin to pray for or talk to. It's about being about what I say is from the harvest to the harvest. I was saved, and because I was saved, I now go about serving the Lord, not because I have to, but because of his love for me. I was reading the Song of Solomon, and she just wanted to stay with a lover, which was the Lord, see if we use it as the Lord, and just stayed in the nice little prayer room. But then he said, come with me, and he wanted to show her places and go places. That's how it is with the Lord. There's time where you have that refreshing where it's just you and him, but then there's times when we go out into the harvest field with him, never alone, because he goes before us and he's with us. And he wants us to reach out to other people who have been in the same situation that we have. So this is our time to serve our generation. I started off with that 40% of people believe in that the Bible is the inspired word of God. And then I forgot to go on with the 50% believe that they can get into heaven without Jesus. 50% of Americans believe that they could get in without Jesus. And 40% of people believe that Satan is a real force. And I'm telling you that Satan is a real force, and he wreaks havoc on our brains and on our minds. And he may not be out with his pitchfork trying to get you that way, but he certainly tries to enslave you with your thinking. I shared a little thing with the kids this week about a prison, the prison of your mind. And Satan is really good at putting us in our boxes and saying this far and no further. As we finish off today, I want us to think about grace is sufficient to win every battle. To win every battle. A lot of people, when this scripture, it says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure in the abundance of this of revelation, a thorn of the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure." You know, that buffeting that can happen, a lot of people think the thorn of the flesh was he had something wrong with his eye. But do you know, God doesn't put diseases and sicknesses on us. What happens in the Old Testament, I think it was in the Israelites, they were told to drive out all the inhabitants. Otherwise, they'd become irritants or thorns in their flesh. And three times it talks about these thorns in the flesh. I think the buffeting that we're talking about here is sometimes what Paul went through. He was shipwrecked, he was beaten, he went through some horrific times in his life, but yet God was with him. And I think the same happens is now with us, is that the enemy comes to try and get us to look at all the negatives, get us caught up in the poor me of the situation. But we know Paul was in prison, and yet he sang and he worshipped, and an angel came to deliver him because his spirit was in a right place. Amazing. Get our hearts in the right place. Love the Lord because of who he is, not because what you can do for him, not any other thing, not about keeping all the rules because it gets you into heaven, but because you love him. Think about the things in your life that we think about is, if I think I'm the righteousness of God in Christ, I will start to act righteously. If I kept thinking about all my past and started to bring back like Paul did in his past and used all of that as my excuses for who I am today, I would never have amounted to anything. I forget those things which are behind. I forget all those excuses, and I run the race to see others saved for the gospel. My last slide today is out of Matthew 28, 18. Jesus says, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." And then he says, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Lo, I am with you, even to the end of the age. Teach them to observe all that I have commanded, for I am with you." I want to finish it there today. If that was you today and any one of you has felt like, yes, that's me, I would like to give my life to the Lord Jesus. It's the best decision you possibly could make. And when you make that decision, it says in the Bible that angels are rejoicing and there's a party that goes on in heaven. Can you imagine that party? But today it's the best decision. There are only two kingdoms. You will either live with God or you will live with the father of the devil, or the father of lies. Many people don't understand this, but if you reject God, the creator of everything, and there is only the other kingdom, it's the kingdom of darkness, how can you expect to make it into heaven when you're not acknowledging him, not believing in all the good things he's done for you, the ability that he gave your life in the first place? There is only two places we can spend. And if you choose not to be with him and you make that decision, remember Jesus said, "I died on the cross so that anybody who would believe in me and what I did would be saved." So today there's a little button that you can click and press, and you can put your hand up if you'd like to make that decision, and somebody this week will get back to you with that. I just pray for everyone as we finish. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus that we've learnt today from the harvest that the greatest mission was that you rescued us, and then you want us now to go out with you to rescue many others. Not because we have to, but because we're so in love with you, Lord, and we want to go. Well, give us that opportunity this week as we go out with our friends and our neighbors to listen, to go out and bring you to this hurting, dying world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Pastor Lisa. And if you'd like to know more about us as a church, this is how you can contact us and find out more about who we are. Have a great week. We'll see you next time.
Falling apart when heaven rescued me. Recovered my heart, I want the world to see. I can testify. From the comforts of my home to a jail cell. They try to break me down, but their plan fails. I remember like yesterday, still clear as day. When I felt I had my whole future stripped away. Should've known better, I felt the heat. Speeding through the lanes, I was looking for the better me. Feeding my desires, ignoring my royal pedigree. Bloodline from the heavens, still slept in the penitentiary. But I was meant for more. So when you say the words I've written, touch you, it's the Lord. The pressure that I felt on me, don't feel it anymore. You sent me healing from above, there's nothing realer than your love. I was falling apart when heaven rescued me. Recovered my heart, I want the world to see. I can testify, I can testify. Ooh, I gave him my life, he gave it back to me. No longer the same, not who I used to be. I can testify, testify.
Yeah, does God still remember I'm here? I need same day delivery for some of my prayers. I close my eyes while my stress and anxiety flare. If it comes up like stairs, I know right on time my God will be there. So many blessings coming down, I don't know if it's real. We not scared, I just feel like we should've be here. But I'm prepared, I got nothing to fear. This is God's plan, young man, and not a career. This a calling, I'm all in, I'm done stalling. I'm done waiting for a better time to tell my story. I know there's power in the name and he reminds me who I am. And even though I'm far from perfect, and never stop this plan.
I was falling apart when heaven rescued me. Recovered my heart, I want the world to see. I can testify, I can testify. Ooh, I gave him my life, he gave it back to me. No longer the same, not who I used to be. I can testify. Testify, I'ma testify. Jesus lifted.